Welcome back, PC World fans. Keith here, and today I'm going to break down graphics card jargon so that you can better understand the graphics card reviews you'll be looking at. Now, I'm guilty as any other reviewer for jumping right into extremely technical language in my own GPU reviews. And I know if you're new to the DIY PC community, or even someone looking to upgrade your pre-built machine, then a lot of the language used by reviewers may go right over your heads. So, let's get into those details. First, let's make sure we're all on the same page about what a graphics card is. At its most basic, a graphics card is an add-in board that has all the components necessary to generate 3D graphics or other graphics-accelerated functions like video playback and provide a display source for the computer. Powering that output is the graphics processing unit, or GPU. And currently, two companies, NVIDIA and AMD, produce them for both the first-party and third-party graphics cards that you can buy. Now, a third company, Intel, will enter the market in the next 6 months or so. But for now, we'll be using NVIDIA and AMD as references throughout this video. Now, as I mentioned, at the heart of every graphics card is the graphics processing unit, commonly referred to as the GPU. Now, it's where all of the acceleration for your GPU-dependent workloads takes place, whether that's pumping out blazing fast frame rates for your competitive gaming experience or speeding up your Adobe Premiere edits. And making it all work are the graphics cores, well, shader cores, and other silicon inside that GPU. So now let's break down what those do. When looking into AMD's Radeon or NVIDIA's GeForce graphics cards, you're going to hear two different terms for graphics cores: compute units or streaming multiprocessors. Radeon cards will refer to compute units, while GeForce cards will call them streaming multiprocessors or SMs. Now, these sit grouped together on the GPU, sharing die space with any other additional silicon dedicated to specialized tasks. And they're what allow the graphics card's performance to scale up and down because they're built on blocks. Now, in reviews and marketing, you'll typically see the total number of these shader cores mentioned more often than the compute unit or the streaming multiprocessor count. Now, in general, the more compute units or streaming multiprocessors you have, the better the performance. But I will stress that compute units and streaming multiprocessors shouldn't be directly compared, as their designs are different for each vendor. Now, inside each compute unit or streaming multiprocessor are shader cores, which again have a different name depending on the vendor. AMD calls them streaming processors, while NVIDIA calls them CUDA cores. Generally speaking, they have similar goals of completing parallel processes as quickly as possible for all GPU functions. But again, they aren't directly comparable in sheer count, so don't buy a graphics card based on it having a higher streaming processor or CUDA core count. That's a common mistake people make when deciding what to buy. The speed at which these shader cores operate is known as the GPU frequency and is typically rated in megahertz. Now, these days, GPUs can operate at very high frequencies, pushing 2000 megahertz and beyond with ease. Some people get caught up in comparing these speeds when choosing graphics cards, but honestly, you can only compare frequencies within architectures and not much else. For example, if you're looking at AMD's RDNA 2 graphics cards, you have to stay within that GPU family when considering frequencies. Any attempts to match up streaming multiprocessors and or compute units, and then also core frequency between different GPU families will not actually tell you which is the most powerful option. If you've read any reviews, you've likely seen the terms TMUs or ROPs listed. So what do they do? Well, TMUs or texture mapping units are basically what they sound like. They're the part within the GPU that fills the scene with the textures needed to keep it from looking like a huge wireframe arrangement. Its speed is measured by the texture fill rate, so keep an eye out for that one as well. Obviously, the faster the better. So what about ROPs? That's the raster output unit, and it handles the last little bit of rendering work that the GPU does before it puts an image on screen. Now, there was a time when the TMUs and ROPs were symmetrical in their count, but they have since been able to run in with different amounts and are no longer tied together within the GPU architectures. Now, depending on the GPU's architecture, it may sometimes come with additional silicon on board beyond the normal parts we've discussed, like asynchronous compute engines in AMD cards that accelerate asynchronous compute functions, or tensor cores in NVIDIA's RTX cards that accelerate machine learning capabilities. As time marches on, we've seen more and more new additional silicon become introduced in graphics cards, so certainly keep an eye out for those when looking over reviews. And the last thing I'll mention related to the GPU cores is the concept of process nodes. Now, process nodes refer back to the semiconductor fabrication process, and marketing departments love to bang their drums about them. And it's for a good reason, though. They do matter. Generally speaking, the lower the number, the newer the technology. Newer process nodes typically bring efficiency gains and allow for higher core frequencies or lower power requirements, or both when there's a jump to an entirely new lower tier number, like from going to 14 nanometers to 10 nanometers. But be aware that each node is named for marketing purposes and aren't really 100% focused on actual measurements. And because of that, they're not really directly comparable between different companies either. At the time of this video, AMD Radeon uses the 7 nanometer node manufactured by TSMC, while NVIDIA GeForce uses a custom 8 nanometer node manufactured by Samsung. Now, the GPU may be the biggest component of a graphics card, but it certainly can't stand alone, and that's where graphics card memory comes into play. Typically, most video cards memory, or VRAM as it's more commonly referred to, is of the GDDR variety. And these days, cards run on GDDR6 for the Radeon side, or either GDDR6 or GDDR6X on the GeForce side. Now, there was a time when we had HBM or high bandwidth type of memory running on consumer grade graphics cards, but that faster memory is now relegated to server and professional markets. Like the GPU, memory has different terms that you should know. So let's dig in just a bit. GDDR stands for Graphics Double Data Rate, and it differs from your typical DDR RAM that you'd put in your motherboard. Instead, this type of memory is entirely designed for working with graphics cards. Currently, we're seeing GDDR6 memory running at a speed of around 16 gigabits per second, which is extremely fast and about twice that of the speed of GDDR5, which ran around 8 gigabits per second. Now, AMD uses GDDR6 on all of its RDNA 2 cards, including the top tier RX 6900 XT. NVIDIA also uses GDDR6 on their Ampere-based cards for the RTX 3070 and lower, but for the RTX 3070 Ti and up, it uses the faster GDDR6X, which operates between 19 and 21 gigabits per second. Now, the memory of the speed modules is only one piece of knowing how fast the memory system is overall. Just as important is the memory's bus width. And this is how wide the memory interface is between the GPU and the memory. The wider the bus, the faster the memory, the greater the bandwidth of memory flow. Think of the bus like a highway. The more lanes or wider it gets, the more cars can move through at once. Even if they all go the same speed, you can get many more cars down a stretch of 8-lane highway rather than you can a 4-lane in the same amount of time. And that's kind of how bandwidth works at a very basic level. Now, that bandwidth is key to overall memory performance. The higher the bandwidth, the faster the data can be fed between the memory and the GPU core. Now, this metric is usually more important as you increase your monitor's resolution and have more pixels to display on the scene at once. The bandwidth requirement to fill out a frame at 1080p is far less than that of a frame at 4K. But Keith, how do AMD's RDNA 2 GPUs hold their own against NVIDIA's Ampere GPUs with a much lower memory bus? Well, that's due to the last level cache, or a small pool of reserve storage on die that holds commonly used memory instructions. Now, AMD calls this Infinity Cache, and basically it functions as a local storage for memory right on the GPU die, so that the GPU doesn't have to shuffle as much data to and from the actual VRAM. It's pretty neat stuff. Now, how much you get depends on the GPU in question. For example, the RX 6600 XT only has 32 megabytes of Infinity Cache, while the higher tier RX 6800 has 128 megabytes. That is a big difference. Naturally, you will have to feed power to all of these components, so I'm just going to brush across the general terminology that you should be on the lookout for. TDP, sometimes known as TGP, is quite divisive when discussing computer components because every vendor seems to use whatever metric is best for them. While TGP is the total graphics power, the TDP of a GPU is supposed to be the thermal design power, or maximum amount of heat generated by the card under normal loads. And many people use this as shorthand for how much power and heat to expect from the graphics card. But I would honestly say on this one, don't get too hung up on that number. rather focus on what the reviews say about actual power draw and the efficacy of the cooling solution for the card you're looking at. Now, the components that handle power delivery are important and sometimes often will be referred to as power phases, chokes, or MOSFETs. They act as transformers by taking the power from the power supply and stepping them down to the proper voltage for the GPU core and the memory. The more of these that exist, the cleaner the step down can be, and that can allow for better power delivery to the GPU and keep it running more consistent in its clock speed, so keep that in mind when researching a graphics card. Now, a graphics card can pull all of the power it needs through the PCIe slot and not require any additional juice. Or it could require the use of multiple 6 or 8 pin PCIe power connectors. Generally, the more powerful the GPU, the more likely you'll need one or more of these power connectors. Now keep an eye out for how many a graphics card requires and make sure that you have those connections available on your power supply. Oh yeah, and be aware that NVIDIA uses a new 12 pin MicroFit connector for its RTX 30 series Founders Edition cards. Now you'll need to make use of the included adapter or an alternative to make it work with your power supply. Some people find the rear ports of the graphics card a bit confusing. It's actually pretty simple. Basically, this is where you plug in your monitors, TVs, or VR headsets. Usually you get a combination of HDMI and DisplayPort connections, but we've also seen recent cards make use of USB Type-C connections. It's useful for monitors that can take advantage of that. Now, what you need to research about these ports is the version of HDMI or DisplayPort you get. Each generation supports different resolutions and refresh rates. For example, HDMI 2.0b caps out at 4K 60Hz, while HDMI 2.1 can go all the way up to 4K 120Hz. Well, that brings this explainer to a close, and I hope at this point you're armed with a bit more knowledge and understanding of what reviews are talking about when these terms are thrown around. There's more to learn for each one, of course, and so if you want to know more about what's in a streaming multiprocessor or in the compute unit or other details along these lines, let us know in the comment section below. And if you enjoyed this video and got something out of it, please hit that like button and make sure you're subscribed here at PC World for even more PC hardware explainers, reviews, and news.